This meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. At this time, I'd ask if we have a motion to reconvene the meeting. Have that motion?
I'll make a motion that we reconvene.
All right, have a second?
I'll second it.
Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, just an FYI, no business was undertaken at the old county courthouse other than opening the meeting and then convening. So that was it. Had one vote and three of us and had a majority, and then we came on down here. So that was the extent of it. With that being said, we're going to go on into our agenda, and then the public hearing will be held first once we finish with the invocation. Please bow your heads. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for living in a nation where we may petition freely, Lord, our government officials, and Father, that we can assemble together in freedom. And Lord, I just pray for this nation, Father, and I pray that that will always be the case. And Lord, as we come to you now, Father, I just pray for wisdom for this board. Father, as we hear the petitions of the citizens that we serve, Lord, just give us guidance and direction during this endeavor. These things I pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Flag's here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Members, I take you've had the opportunity to look over the agenda, and I'd ask at this time if there's any changes to be made in the agenda tonight. Hearing no changes, do I have a motion of approval of the agenda?
So move.
Second.
Second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, members. This time we'll get into the public hearing, and I'd like to thank each person for being here tonight. Some rules that we have. I notice we have sign-up sheets, but let me say this. Each person here will have the opportunity to come up. We've reserved two rows for public speakers, and as you see, those rows aren't full. If you'd like to come down and sit, if your name's on the list, you may do so. But before this board leaves here tonight, anybody that's in this room that wishes to speak to these county commissioners, our board, will have the opportunity to do that. With that in mind, also there will be a timer. You will be able to see how much time you have left. There's a three-minute limit on the time, and there's a reason for that. We've got about 50 odd speakers, and if you say three times 50, you'll understand how long we're going to be here tonight, and that's fine. Again, that is a fine thing and no problems. There will be no dialogue between the commissioners and the speaker as they speak. In other words, the speakers will have the opportunity to speak. Commissioners will be listening. And then once we have finished, that is when the commissioners, each one will have the opportunity, if they like to speak on a subject that's brought up, the matter that's brought up about the budget. So that's where we're at. All I ask is, as we start, is that when you come up to the front, you give us your name. Now, there's two different lists here, and let me explain those. I have a list on the agenda of names of people that filed electronically to speak. So they filed prior to coming in here tonight. They will be taken first. And then once we have finished that list, then I will take the list that I have in my hand here. We'll go through it, and then at that time I'll ask, are there any others here that would like to speak? And you'll be able to come forward. Now, if I don't have your name here, and each of you, please just identify by your name as you start. We just ask that. And with that, I will call on our first speaker, and it is Dr. William Harrison.
Chairman Engel and fellow commissioners, Manager Honeycutt, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you. I am Bill Harrison, superintendent of the Alamance-Burlington school system. Over a period of about 2 years, this community came together and did an extraordinary effort defining and developing a vision for public education. It's a vision that any community would be proud to call its own. And basically, it's about empowering all students and becoming a national model. And I think that's doable. We can make that happen. And I think it's also important to note that public education is economic development. It doesn't play a role in economic development. It is economic development. If we're going to see the returns on our education system, if we're going to develop economically, we must invest in our public schools. Our strategic plan came from that vision, and we're going to focus on teaching and leadership. We have to have the best teachers for all of our children. Specialized programs, we realize that all children have special needs and special interests, and we need to respond to them, and we can't feed everybody out of one spoon. A facilities plan, and three of you had the opportunity to serve on our task force and see the dire need of our facilities. Working conditions, making sure the conditions that we have are optimal for all of our teachers. Compensation for our building level employees, and central support to the schools. We've determined that it will take about $25 million to get where we want to go, and we realize we can't get from A to Z overnight, so we're looking at a 5 to 10 year plan to do that, and we think we were very systematic, very intentional, and very strategic about how we developed this budget. We recognize it will take time, and we were very, very thoughtful. We actually cut $2.5 million from our current operating expense to get where we are with our $3.4 million request. While all requests are explicitly tied to the goals, this budget is primarily about our people, at the school level, in the classroom. We have got to ensure that our teachers' salaries are competitive. We are losing too many teachers to our surrounding counties. We need to make sure that our principals' salaries are competitive. We're not going to have great teachers if we don't have great principals. We've lost three principals to Durham and Orange County since I've been here in July. So I ask you to carefully consider the manager's recommendation and do better than that. We requested $750,000 to get started on our capital plan. We hope to work together to develop a 5 to 10 year strategic plan for facilities, but we need to get started. We were only allotted by the county manager $250,000, and that will barely get us started. So we ask that you make the difficult, courageous decision and do what's right for the 22,700 children that attend schools and ABSS every day. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Alan Gant, Jr. Welcome, Mr. Gant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I appreciate immensely you allowing me the opportunity to speak with you tonight. With all the energy that I can muster, I would encourage you to have the courage to put the school budget as originally proposed through in its entirety. If we don't invest in our children, invest in our teachers, our principals, and our system, then we as a county fail. If we don't have educated people, then we don't have a workforce, and we're not competitive. Unfortunately, we have neglected this system for a long time. It's obvious if you walk into the schools. It's obvious if you walk around the schools. I think it's the same cover on that chair that I sat in 1961. This is a moment in which we as a community need to come together and invest. And if you need to raise taxes, do it. If you raise the maximum that you're talking about, it will cost Glen Raven $50,000 to $60,000. We're all in. We absolutely embrace what you have to do to make us competitive in education. If we don't have education, then we fail as a community. And now is the time for us to stop neglecting but invest in the most prized asset we have, the future of this county and the children that are here. Remember, education is the only thing spoken of in the North Carolina Constitution. Please use your courage and invest in this opportunity. We stand ready and willing to help in any way that we can. Please, for God's sakes, call on us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Ron Shive. Welcome.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, I wish that you could have seen it. The line was long, but it was moving briskly, and in that line, at the very end, was a young mother. A young mother about 20 years of age, and she waited patiently. She waited patiently as those at the front of the line received a little rice and some canned goods, a little piece of fruit. Slowly but surely, she was getting closer to the front of that line, closer to the food. From time to time, she would glance across the street. She didn't seem to notice, though, the concern on those who were passing out the food. The food was running out. Their anxiety was beginning to show. Her attention was always focused on the three children across the street, under the trees. At long last, she stepped forward to the front of the line to get her food. But the only thing that was left was one little banana. The workers were almost ashamed to tell her what was left, but she didn't seem to mind. In fact, she seemed grateful for what she received. And she got that one solitary banana, and she ran back across the street. She took that precious gift, and very deliberately she peeled that banana, and very carefully she divided that banana into three parts. And she placed it into three eager hands that were waiting. Her own children, one for you, and one for you. And then she sat down and she licked the inside peel of that banana. I swear, I saw the face of God. I did see the face of God, for I saw the face of God reflected on the face of a mother who would do anything for the welfare of her children. And there does come a time when a parent will do anything that is necessary for the welfare of their children. And you and I, and each person in this room, indeed, are the father and the mothers of all the children of Alamance County. They're ours, all 22,700 children of the Alamance Burlington school system, all 12,000 children birth age to five, indeed. They're our children, your children, my children, our children. Sometimes we don't act like it, but they're our children. And sometimes parents are called to sacrifice for the well-being of their children. And now is the time in Alamance County for us to sacrifice for the well-being of our children. So I hope that you, the members of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, will indeed recognize this urgent need, and you indeed will support improving our children's education. And when you do, I know that others will see the face of God reflected on your face.
Thank you, Mr. Shive. Thank you. Mr. Michael Schmierder. I hope I got to pronounce it.
Actually, it was very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you for allowing us to speak tonight. I would like to express my support for the county budget as it is, and I'd like to address two of the points that we've seen specifically. Number one, the county employee pay raises and benefits. In June 1st, a publication of the Times News, there was a statement published that one of the commissioners believed that the increase in salary and benefits makes it look like the county government was created to serve the employees rather than the employees serving the county government. I find that statement and that sentiment to be very disappointing and discouraging. The county employees are not our servants. They perform jobs that provide services for us as citizens, but they do not serve us. They are family members, they are husbands and wives, and they have mortgages and rents and car repairs and their own kids to think about. They've worked for us for a long time, and it is time for us to be responsible citizens to provide compensation for those services. And I wish that interests be taken into consideration that the services that we get, we should be responsible for paying members of our community. The second issue that I like to address is the education funding. This is the first time in the past 8 years that I've lived in this community that I have seen the county commissioners, the Board of Education, and members of the community come together and collaborate on a mission and a vision for education in this community. Now, I have not lived here my entire life, but I have lived in other places where I have seen various successes in education between county governments and boards of education. And I have to say that I am very pleased at the positive movement that we have made in the last few years. The vision, the mission of ABSS is very important. We have a great deal of people that we have won, companies that have come in. We've had Sheets, we have Walmart, we've had GE, Honda Aero just got FAA, their first FAA accreditation. Let's show companies that are looking to come here to invest and bring jobs that we as citizens are willing to support the infrastructure of our children and our education system so that we can better the living standard of everybody in the county. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Rick Adams. I'm sorry. I apologize, Mr. Adams. I skipped the man in front of you, Mr. Joe Tickle. I apologize.
Joe can go first if he wants to.
I'll leave it. All right. Mr. Adams, and then Mr. Tickle, I'll come back and get you, Joe.
I came tonight to thank Commissioner Smith for speaking up for senior citizens, the working poor, and small businesses, businessmen and women in the county. Just a few other things. You've got a copy of what I had to say. Years ago when I was a kid, a local police officer came to our house because it was a break-in. While he was there, I asked this police officer why he became a police officer, and he said, because I didn't want to work in the mills. In those days, as we all know, the mills were the highest paying employers in the county. And that certainly has changed because there's not a lot of mills left in the county anymore. Another couple of things I wanted to mention is private business normally only gives raises maybe every 2 or 3 years and never over 4%. In a lot of private businesses, management does not get a raise unless the business is doing well. They just simply don't get it. And last but not least in the list of what I gave you, in the 2013, I guess, census, this was in the Times News, the median household income in Alamance County was $43,043. And the per capita income in 2013 was $23,166 per year. Now, everything that the Alamance News printed, even the lowest paid salary they had printed, is way beyond $23,166 per year, which probably hadn't changed all that much since 2013. And I can assure you there's senior citizens living on less than $23,166 per year. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Mr. Joe Tickle. And I apologize again, Mr. Tickle.
That's okay. I come here to talk to you about the senior citizens and the poor people here in this county. They can't stand a tax raise. They live week to week. I got a business, and they come by, and I have to work with them. You know, can you hold this till I get my check? Can you do this? Can you do that? And they just can't—they can't make it. I mean, you can't put another expense on them. And second thing I talked to you about is when you folks were running, or at least when two of you, two of you were running in the last election, you said that the tax rate was about right. Now, what happened? We hadn't been here long. And then the other person running said that they would increase taxes only and absolutely if necessary after all funding cuts had been exhausted. Have we done that? Has anybody asked the manager to look in to see, can you cut this, can you cut that? A good example of wasting money is all these consultants being hired. Seems like you have to hire a consultant to tell somebody how to screw a light bulb in. And the people have been doing that all their life. They don't need a consultant to tell them how to do that. I mean, you know, they can do the work themselves. Why a consultant's hired, I don't know. So I ask you to, when you vote, you think about the poor people. You think about the elderly that don't have any money. There is people in this county that don't have money. And I ask you to, when you vote, you think about those, and you vote straight. And for those of you who don't know what straight means, it's not straight, it's crooked. And if you take from the elderly and the poor people in this county, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tickle. Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Stuart Smith.
Thank you, Chairman Engel, Commissioners. I thank you for the opportunity to speak. I would like to speak tonight in favor of the superintendent's budget request being fully funded. My name is Stuart Smith. I'm an employee of Coca-Cola Bottling Company Consolidated. I'm speaking tonight not as an employee of my company, or any group, but as a concerned citizen, I would like to speak in support of the superintendent's budget. My job duties include, but are not limited to, visiting all schools that my company has contracts with. At schools where we have vending machines, my responsibilities include ensuring that the machines are operating per approved guidelines. We sell bottled water and other approved items in school. When I arrive at a school, I check in at the front office and sign in, where I am furnished with a visitor's badge. I am usually at each location 30 minutes or less. When I finish my maintenance issue, I check out at the front office as I leave. Although I am only at each location briefly, I sometimes get a snapshot of what our school systems in North Carolina encounter on a daily basis. My territory includes Alamance, Orange, Guilford, Rockingham, Chatham, Davidson, Moore, and Montgomery counties. At the beginning of each school year, I often have newly constructed schools to visit. In some cases, some locations, new additions have been added to existing buildings and are done in a very aesthetically pleasing manner, saving millions of dollars. One thing that I have observed with regard to staff is that administrators, teachers, and support staff will cross county lines if a better opportunity presents itself, or if they see a friendlier environment for their profession. I see familiar names and faces from Alamance County frequently in other counties. These are people we need to keep in Alamance County. We must be competitive with neighboring counties, or we will continue to lose our best and brightest. As our society has changed, our schools have had to deal with more and more challenges. Our school social workers are now an integral part of our school system. More and more children come to school without the support system at home to encourage them and work with them. In some cases, a teacher may be the most responsible adult in a child's life. We need to have class size proportionate to allow ample instructional time for a child who may be struggling. Our seasoned veteran teachers are coveted by other school systems. In our high schools, a veteran, seasoned teacher that can command the respect of their students is very highly coveted by other school systems. Positions and pay requested in the superintendent's budget are about providing the best opportunity for our children. It's not about teachers, it's about our children, and we need to step up. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Mr. Pat Nadowski, our district attorney.
Good evening, Dan Engel, and your fellow commissioners. I was about to say Representative Dan Engel. My name's Pat Nadowski. I'm the district attorney for Alamance County, and I'm here in that position. Our prosecutor's offices across the state of North Carolina have been underfunded by the state legislator for decades. Recently, the legislator has passed laws with the Justice Reinvestment Act that has put pressure on our jails for housing our defendants. Now, misdemeanants have to serve their sentences in our local jails. It can no longer go to the Department of Corrections. And just recently, those defendants that are convicted of DWIs also have to serve their sentences in our local jail, not the Department of Corrections. The result of this is that there is a significant pressure and overcrowding problem that is growing across the state of North Carolina. And this is only going to get worse as time goes on. I'm asking you all to support a special jail prosecutor on a trial basis for the upcoming year. It has been said to me, and it's been asked to me, why isn't the state legislator funding this position, adequately funding you? And the answer is, I ask them that all the time. But it doesn't change the fact that we need another prosecutor. It doesn't change the fact that our jail is going to become overcrowded. It doesn't change the fact that public safety is an interest for us all. Just like education, public safety is important. So with that in mind, I do ask for your support for this position. I have talked to Sheriff Terry Johnson, and he's also in support of this. And I've talked to several of the county commissioners. This would be a trial basis. I think it would be efficient because it would save the jail money in the long run by us prosecuting these crimes proactively and efficiently and getting those people completed in our jail system. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Paul Koontz. Welcome, sir.
Good evening. My name is Paul Koontz, and tonight I'm here on behalf of the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce. I'm on their board of directors and serve as their vice chair of membership development. And Mr. Jeff Andrews has spoken to you before. He's fortunate enough to be on vacation tonight, so he doesn't get the prime time spotlight. Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce has about 800 members, business owners in this community, and our board strongly supports the full funding of the budget request that has been submitted by the Alamance Burlington School System. One of the core missions of the chamber is to promote the health and success of our local economy, and we believe that the strong educational system that supports workforce development is vital to our local economic success. To that end, the Chamber has been very involved in the vision planning process and also supports the implementation of the strategic plan that is being developed by Alamance Burlington School Systems. We have seen too many plans lay on the shelf. We don't want this plan to lay on the shelf and gather dust. We want to move forward, and the only way to do that is to put money behind it. Proper funding by the county at this time of incredible momentum in the community is critical to our future success. Momentum is not an easy thing to build, and it is an easy thing to lose. Anybody who's ever watched a ball game knows that it can slide one way or the other very quickly. And if you don't grab it when you have that opportunity, you lose that opportunity. And that's where we are now. We have momentum moving forward with the school system and with the strategic plan, and the chamber will continue to devote time and effort and personnel to this because we believe it helps our economy grow. And as we bring new businesses to this community, it helps the tax base grow. All of these things work together. In order for us to become a world-class educational system, that's one of the goals of the vision plan, it's going to take our entire community working together. Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce stands ready as a partner to continue moving forward. We ask that you do your part. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cook. Mr. Pete Glidewell. Welcome.
Thank you for this opportunity to address the County Commission, and I'd first like to start off by congratulating Reverend Ron Shive on giving a sermon that was delightful in 2 minutes and 56 seconds, which may make Sunday services at First Presbyterian shorter this year. I come to support the proposed new property tax rate plan in order for us to escape the mandated mediocrity of an underfunded county. We must adequately fund public education, have a competent county workforce, have effective law enforcement, and have an aggressive business recruitment effort. For the 50 cents a day extra that Beth and I will have to pay, I'm trying to ensure that my property value doesn't go down another $40,000 as it has done since 2008. To me, this is a prudent investment. It can only happen if we have a vibrant community that attracts residents and businesses. I agree that we must be competitive, though, with our neighbors in order to do this. Our proposed tax rate will still be the lowest of any county that we touch. It's 16% lower than the average. It's 4% lower than the next lowest, which is Chatham County at 62 cents. It's 27% lower than our I-40, I-85 neighbors on either side of us who are our main competition, with Guilford at 77 cents and Orange at 87 cents. Effective leadership provides a vision for a community that is a great place to live, to learn, and to do business. Our commission has provided us with a transparent plan to do all three of these things. This plan provides aggressive support for public education, based on a vision that will make us the best. It provides a competitive tax base for which we can still offer incentives to new businesses, as well as businesses that are here willing to expand. It funds an effective law enforcement community to keep us safe. I want to thank the Commission for having the wisdom, foresight, and indeed the courage to propose a plan for us to succeed and still have us remain the most economical place in the area to live. Thank you, and I yield back my 36 seconds.
Thank you. Miss Jennifer Talley.
Hi, Commissioners. Luke. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak tonight. I represent business owners, and I can tell you that having a low tax rate is something that absolutely businesses look at. I can assure you, I used to work for a large corporation that, and that's what I did was look at where do we want to go. And when we're looking at where we want to go in other states we know nothing about, one of the first things that we look at is the tax rate. So, I mean, I can sit here and list off 15 other counties that have tax rates, the rate of ours are lower. So there's plenty of, you know, argument to say, you know, throwing money at the problem, does that just fix it? I mean, I don't see how anybody can look at these numbers, and the numbers that I ask you to look at are not the numbers that are given to you by Craig Honeycutt. I ask you to look at the numbers from the NC Department of Treasury for the last 5 years. If you go to the NC Department of Treasury and you look at the last five-year comparison and you see how our county has grown, its tax basis. I mean, just last year, every single year that this administration, that this management provides to the county commissioners a list of all of the revenues that it thinks it's going to receive, consistently, year after year after year, we have brought in more money, millions of dollars more than what we anticipated in the budget. And they spent that too. So it's like, you know, you can say I'm gonna bring in, you know, $52 million and bring in an extra $2 million and they're gonna spend that too. It just seems like throwing money at things does not seem to solve the problem. And when you look at other counties in North Carolina and you see that they have population larger than Alamance County, and they're able to do so much more with less money, you have to ask yourself, how can we better manage the money that and the funds that we have? Just from last year to this year, the tax basis grew by $200 million. $200 million, which is in the budget. So if we're going to receive revenues based on the current tax rate, not changing the tax rate at all, we're going to get an additional, you know, increase in our tax base by $200 million. So, you know, when we're looking at these things and what we want to spend our money on, you know, I called the administration today and talked about where the money was going. 15 new social worker jobs for North Carolina, for the North Carolina FAST implementation plan. 15 new social worker jobs that are at $41,000 a year times 15. You know, I'm sorry, but the property tax owners of North Carolina, of Alamance County, we do not use the services necessarily of social services.
Thank you, Ms. Taylor.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next we have Ms. Catherine Frazier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. I thank you for this opportunity to speak. My name is Catherine Frazier, and I live in Graham. I was born and raised in Alamance County, and after several years of working in larger cities, I realized that a lot of progress was being made in my hometown, and I was tired of just hearing about it. I wanted to be here, wanted to see it. So I've been back here for 5 years, and I now manage a small business that is based out at the Burlington Alamance Regional Airport. In that time, I've had the opportunity to meet professionals from many of Alamance County's large employers, specifically Honda Aero, Elon University, and LabCorp. More often than not, the people who I meet have chosen not to live in Alamance County. They would prefer to drive 30 minutes into work every day and enjoy a quality of life that they don't see possible here. These are often young families, and schools are a big consideration. Even my husband and I sometimes wonder if Alamance County is still the best place for our kids, but we have chosen to stay here because we know that progress is being made and that we already enjoy a vibrant business scene, strong leadership, and a wonderful close-knit community that truly sets us apart from our neighbors. Those things represent our potential and make me believe that we can compete with our neighboring counties, that we can be the chosen home for the employees when we land an exciting new business. But in order to fulfill that potential, we've got to first make the investment. Until we do, we face the opportunity cost of all the families who drive here for work but spend their money and their property tax dollars in other counties. Even more, we face the cost of losing too many teachers to other districts where they can provide a better living for their families. And that hurts all the kids who live here now and who deserve quality education every bit as much as the kid who lives across the county line. The proposed property tax increase may not be easy for some, and I am sympathetic to that, but the return will benefit everyone in Alamance County. So, Commissioners, I urge you to take this opportunity and make the needed investment so that our community and our kids can all compete in what might be a very bright future. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Eddie Shue.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Rest assured, God didn't speak to me and tell me to be here. More likely it was the devil. This is insane. You know, brother, you look back behind me at the empty seats, which y'all expected to be full. I'm speaking for the empty seats, the ones that have given up, the ones who know this is a farce. They don't vote now, and they're going to vote less. You have your voting majority, county employees, teachers, and their supporters. So you win. They know that. They're not dumb. They've been treadmarks down their back since the days of Tent City and the cotton mill houses, hill houses. the company store, sharecropping. They've had these feet down their back and people telling them we're moving you forward all those years. So that's why they're not here. And you're helping it. Again, you're helping it tonight with what y'all are pulling. Yes, there's probably an untold number. They will read in the paper tomorrow how much you're costing them and just hang their heads down, trudge off to work, and say, the man got me again. That's all it can say, because that's what you're doing. You know what you promised when you signed them things, just like I did, answered the questions in the paper. I didn't expect to win, but I did get to tell the truth. I'm proud of that. I said I'd only raise taxes if the expansion of the tax base fit. That's why you raise the extra money. I said I wouldn't raise taxes, but you would raise more taxes. I hope you get my point. 9 grades of education don't go so far even with a GED. Oh, by the way, I wouldn't dance. I happen to be in the Junior Beta Club and tap for the National Honor Society. Teacher said you can get scholarships. Trouble. Teacher never told me what a scholarship was, and I didn't have time to find out with the chores at home. We were so poor that I actually had people tell me, said, poor people look down on y'all. So, make some more poor people, because I hope in the public meeting to tell you a little story about a poor person you're making that I actually can cite an example of from personal knowledge. Good luck to you. You got a tough job, but you're dealing with the wrong people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shue. Ms. Stephanie Braxton.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Stephanie Braxton, and I am the Executive Director for Alamance Citizens for Education, but I am also a parent with school-aged children. I'm here tonight to encourage you all to support the ABSS budget request. In my position, I have had the privilege of working with wonderful teachers and administrators in our public schools. I have seen firsthand how incredibly hard they all work. They deserve to be paid at a competitive rate. I believe that the citizens of Alamance County realize that certain needs have been ignored or delayed or underfunded for way too long. I also believe that the citizens realize that the county budget, with full school funding, carries with it a suggested tax increase, and they are prepared to pay that price. Last year, business leaders and community stakeholders created a vision plan for education in Alamance County. That vision included the belief that when bolstered by an excellent public school system, Alamance County can become one of the most desired destinations of new business and industry, and the most desired place to live, work, and raise a family. Our Board of Education and superintendents have taken that vision and developed a well-thought-out and very progressive strategic plan that is devoted to promoting excellence in our schools. The plan is committed to recruiting and retaining high quality staff. But in order to make that happen, we must provide community and professional support, which includes a competitive compensation. Our public schools have a vision of where we want to go. We have a roadmap of how we can get there. And now we need the resources to make it a reality. Education is an investment. I hope you will show your support as a leader of this county by granting our schools their full budget request. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jerry Dawes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
and board members, Mr. the county manager. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight. And I know some of the ladies and gentlemen of the board. I know you're fair and respectable people, and I want to speak in that same vein. In 60 years of paying property taxes, I have never complained about the tax rate or paying my fair share. We have a corporation in Hall River where we also pay city property tax and fire tax. And I don't have a problem with most of the proposed budget. Some areas need and want additional funding. And this is not going to be real popular with a lot of people, but I do very much oppose raises for the one segment of our society, only the county employees. And I'll give you my reasoning for that. In the real world, private business and workers have struggled to survive. Many, including myself, have taken pay cuts and shorter hours in order to keep their jobs or businesses since 2008. I think Eddie and Linda both can relate to that very well in the housing industry. In the world of business, raises of 25 cents or a dollar per hour are common, if at all, in these times. Raises of $5,000 to $20,000 per year are only a dream. Please be considerate of all your constituents. Now, I'm going to make a suggestion, and I do make a budget for our company and how for 50 years. My suggestion is to cut the $3 million county employee portion and keep the point, what was it, 0.2 or 0.3 million left over? Wasn't it 3.2? And divide it among the lowest pay grades who need it the most. And I would include in those raises starting deputies and those who serve and protect. To fund this proposed budget would be unconscionable and totally unfair to workers and poor taxpayers of our great county. In business, we can't just raise prices to increase our income because we have to be competitive. Just this past month, we took a contract for a lot of work and we had to cut our prices instead of raising them. We had to cut them to get it.
Thank you,
and
Mr.
we're going to be operating on a slim budget, but please don't raise our taxes just because you can.
Thank you, sir. Next we have Dana Roseborough. Welcome, Ms. Roseborough.
Good evening. My name is Dana Roseborough, and I'm the assistant principal at Grove Park Elementary School. I've just completed my 25th year in education, 20 of those right here in Alamance County. I also have a daughter who attends Turntime Middle School. I'm here tonight to ask you to please pass the full funding for the schools, along with the recommended tax increase that's needed to make it happen. While I realize that no one likes the idea of a tax increase, I also know that Alamance County is in dire need of more funds in order to meet the needs of this community. Speaking directly for the schools, I've watched over the years as school buildings have become overcrowded, understaffed, and the capital needs have gone unmet. According to General Statute 115C-408, it is the policy of the state of North Carolina that the facilities requirements for a public education system are met by the county governments. Therefore, we cannot rely on our state government to take care of our building and facility needs throughout the school system. We must rely on you. The saying goes, you get what you pay for. I would say that is definitely reflected in what this county has been willing to pay over the years. I teach in a school that is well over 50 years old and is severely overcrowded. We had to dismantle our computer lab to make a classroom. We had to turn a former equipment room into a third grade classroom. We have intervention and ESL classes that meet in closets. And by closet, I do not mean a small room. I literally mean a paper closet with no windows that has been turned into a room for children. There are no spare spaces. I went into a classroom on Friday to see the sink where the faucet has literally rusted off and fallen into the sink. These are just small examples that are playing out in our schools across the county. Most of these schools are located in our highest need areas. I'm sure our facilities manager can make you aware of even greater capital needs that have not been funded over the years. While full funding this year will not solve all of our school system's needs, it will at least get us started on the right road. Our system has developed a strategic plan to meet its needs, but we need your help to fund it. I feel like over the past several years, the county commissioners who were in office failed the students of this county. We must remember that these are not somebody else's children. Whether you currently have a child in school, these are our children. They are the future of Alamance County. I'm asking that you, as our new county commissioner board, please support their future and the future of our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Tom Gamble. Welcome,
thank you, Chairman Engel, and other board members for this opportunity to speak to you tonight and for the public to be here. I am a supporter of public education everywhere, actually, especially in Alamance County, because I have 7 grandchildren that will be educated in these schools. I want to suggest that we piggyback on the strategy that my fellow speaker, Dr. Gatewood, that's going to follow me shortly, has adopted, the Center of Excellence. I think the county can benefit from a similar strategy. It's really a business marketing principle of branding. We need something to differentiate Alamance County and making public education number one in the world as envisioned by the Citizens Committee is certainly a worthy objective. I do share concerns about increasing tax rates for disabled and low-income elderly people. I do want to point out, you probably already know that there is a Homestead Act, which is a state of North Carolina provision for tax relief. It is designed for disabled and low-income elderly people, and I'm sure our tax office is very able to help anyone access this benefit. I think some recent letters to the editor have not been factual, and I would encourage everyone to investigate the Homestead Act that does provide some relief. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next we have Ms. Tracy Grazer. Welcome.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm Tracy Grazer. I've lived here in the county for over 15 years. My son's in the public schools here in Elon. I'm also the president of a local organization, Impact Alamance. Impact Alamance invests in the hope, health, and prosperity of our community. We also have 6 values that are key to our organization, and one of them is courageous leadership. And that's what I wanted to touch on briefly this evening. Courage. It was Nelson Mandela who said that courage is not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not one who feels afraid, but he who overcomes it. Change is never easy, and going against the status quo can be scary. And there are a lot of people who are going to try to use fear to keep things as they have always been. I want to thank you for having the courage to do what's right for our community. The proposed budget demonstrates your commitment to investing in our county through our public servants and our school system. Our organization's vision is for Alamance County to be the best place to live and thrive, and what potential we have. Until every child, regardless of zip code, has the opportunity to get a great start in life, an excellent K-12 experience, and some type of post-secondary education that leads them to gainful employment, we know that that vision won't come to fruition. All of the research shows that education is the cornerstone of a healthy and a vibrant community. The higher one's educational attainment, the better physical, economic, and mental health outcomes they have as adults. Education creates opportunity. The proposed budget invests in a plan to move Alamance County forward. It is the first step toward moving us to the world-class school system that this county envisions for our children. It places resources behind a strategic plan with measurable outcomes, one that supports our teachers, our students, and ultimately our community's success. It is an investment in our future and one that benefits us all. Thank you for working with the school system and supporting this vision for public education. I would urge you to support ABSS with the full amount requested by the school system and to have the courage it will take to increase the resources needed to make these investments come to fruition. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Algie Gatewood, Alamance Community College. Welcome, sir.
Good evening. How are you, sir? Good. Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Commissioners, I am Algie Gatewood, President of Alamance Community College, and I stand before you tonight to thank you for your continued support of ACC. Joining me tonight, I have two members of our Board of Trustees and several members of our staff, and I would ask them to please just stand and be recognized, Trustee Bill Gomery and Trustee Jerry Bailey, and of course the staff. Your support undergirds the college's mission to respond to diverse community needs and empower the people of Alamance County to participate in a 21st century global economy. Your support represents an investment in this county and signifies your recognition of Alamance Community College as a key economic driver committed to critical job skills, training, and workforce development. And that is exactly what it takes to recruit new industry and to retain the industry we have. And with your support, we can become one of the best community colleges in this state. In fact, we can become one of the best community colleges in this nation, one that you can be extremely proud. Let me just close by saying that we thank you again for your past support. We thank you for your present support and for your future support. And every dollar that you invest in Alamance Community College, you are investing in the betterment of this county and all the people in it for many decades to come. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Mr. Adam Shoemaker.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you tonight. My name is Adam Shoemaker, and I stand before you as a concerned parent and pastor to ask that you fully fund the ABSS budget request. It is my privilege to pastor a congregation with a long-standing commitment to public education in this county, Holy Comforter Episcopal Church. And the recent iteration of that commitment has been a wonderful, life-giving, three-year partnership with nearby Newland Elementary School, led by the very charismatic principal, Larry Conti. We've sent in tutors to that school. We've sent in reading buddies. We've created a backpack program. We have a summer camp for some of the kids from that school. And most recently, we are nearing the point where we are ready to open our doors for a bilingual play school, because we have come to realize that far too many children, particularly Spanish-speaking children, begin kindergarten already behind the eight ball. We've seen a lot of need at Newland Elementary School. It's really opened the eyes of many of my parishioners. We see the need to recruit and retain good teachers, men and women who are truly called to the vocation of teaching. We've seen the need to support those teachers with classroom assistance. We've seen the need of keeping classroom size small. And as other speakers have pointed out, we've seen the need of investing in our physical plants to make sure that all of our county's children have the space that they need to learn and to grow. As Ms. Grazer, I think, rightly pointed out, to invest in this fully is going to require courage. My congregation, just this past weekend, buried a man of great courage, when it comes to the area of public education, John Freeman. And I would appeal to you in the spirit of the legacy of John Freeman to be courageous and forward-thinking and investing in the future of our county's children so that no child in this county gets left behind. And we really need to focus on the poor and the marginalized. The children of Newland Elementary School, East Long Elementary School, elementary schools like it, they'll be the first ones to get left behind if we don't make public education a priority. As Larry Conte told me today, a great school is like church 180 days out of the year. Help us to continue to make all of our schools great. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're moving to the second page, and there were many duplications, and I've gone through the list as closely as possible to cross them out. So if I call your name, you've already spoken, just raise your hand and I'll take you off the list. I do apologize if that happens. Next we have Mr. John Thorpe.
Thank you. I'm John Thorpe. Alamance Burlington School Systems has been underfunded since I was a student there. That's over a decade of shortchanging our future. Although our representatives in Raleigh have voted to cut public education or not use it adequately, Alamance, the Board of Education still came up with an amazing plan to give a world-class education to the future of Alamance County. At this moment, the driver's education program will cease to exist because of the funding is not there. This will create more 16-year-olders driving illegally, and so that law enforcement can arrest them and charge them with driving without license, giving them a criminal record at such a tender age, and that ain't right. Do you know who are going to these public schools? The next veterinarian, the next doctor, the next lawyer, the guy who could potentially cure cancer is at your school right now, but they will never live up to these dreams because they're struggling with reading, writing, math, science. And the only reason they will not live up to their dreams is because some people on the board may be afraid to raise a few thousand people tax property taxes 6.5 cents. The impact that the shortage will have at extracurricular activities in the future of Alamance County is dire. As the lady from Impact Alamance said, they are joining forces with the Board of Education to move Alamance County to the Strive program that has been so successful in Forsyth County. And I talked to one of the commissioners in Forsyth County about how successful that program has been. But the only way that the Strive program can possibly live is if the funding is there for the extracurricular activities. The Broadview Middle School is moving to a more adapt dress code for the area. And if each parent uses a coupon, they will have to spend $87 a week, just so their kids can be dressed properly. So that's not gonna happen. So these teachers have to spend this money, and that ain't right. Currently, the county manager budget will keep a school like Southern High School without having a roof to be repaired, and no student should be trying to learn in an education environment where it's a leaky roof, and that ain't right. So what I'm asking y'all to do is, please, just do what's right. Give Alamance Burlington School Systems and the Board of Education every dime they request, or we will have more people being locked up and more tax dollars going to feed them while they're waiting trial. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thorpe. Thank you. Mr. Thomas Weaver. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioner, for giving me the opportunity to speak. My name is Thomas Weaver, Alamance County citizen. I'd first like to say my wife worked for this county for 30 years. She never asked for a raise. She was always satisfied with what she made. She was a satisfied employee, and she did a good job, and she didn't do it for money. Yes, she, at the end, she was making good money,
but she worked her way up. A 6.5% raise, property tax raise is too much. Who ever heard of raising taxes in 1 year this much? I had confidence in these commissioners before they was elected. I felt like we needed a change on the board. And it's a funny thing, we go from the property tax being about right 8 months ago in November to a 6.5% now. The board that was on here before, it ain't no way they would have ever approved anything like this. It's just too much in 1 year. You just don't grow and put the burden on the taxpayers. I'm not speaking for myself about paying tax. I'm doing okay. But I'm thinking about all the people that rent from me and the employees that work for me that work for $30,000 or $35,000 a year, and that comes up to about $17 per hour, not counting all the expense that goes with that $17 an hour. They are experienced, qualified men. Carpenters, plumbers, you know, they got families to support. And I'm not saying the lower paid employees don't deserve a raise. Anybody making $50,000 or less might deserve a raise. And that would be still good money. You can't find many employees in the construction business making $50,000 a year. It's not out there. And they work in all kinds of weather conditions. This week, it's going to be tough, but they're going to be out trying to make a living. But the upper management should not get $19,000 to $18,000 a raise in 1 year. That is plumb ridiculous. So I ask that your mind not be made up before you got here tonight. I wish you wouldn't even pass the budget tonight. You need to think about it. And a teacher or a carpenter or a plumber or anybody else, the main thing for their job should not be the money. Are you doing it because you love the kids? As many graduates as we got coming out of college, the workforce will be there.
Thank you, Mr. Weaver. Appreciate it. Next we have Mr. Worf Zimmerman. Okay, thank you. Moving on, next we have Mr. Mike Holland. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm Mike Holland, and I have sited my company in Southern Alamance for the last 20 years. There are around 1,000 county employees in Alamance, and Alamance is quickly becoming the training ground for these employees to move to nearby counties that have a better pay and better funding. They have not had a raise, these employees, in years, and with furloughs, they've actually taken a financial hit. We as a community count on these individuals every single day. Teachers and school staff, law enforcement and emergency personnel, social services, library staff, the innovative director, Greg Thomas at the landfill, equally innovative director of park and recreation, Brian Baker, whose staff is out teaching children the importance of preserving nature, equally as important as teaching math in my estimation. If we each chip in just a little more, we can stop being the training ground for other better funded counties that surround us. Let's train and keep our employees and reward them properly for helping to make Alamance County the best place to work, play, and live. And that's the end of my prepared statement. I've got about a minute 30. I've listened to two sides of a very important debate, but everybody wants the best thing for our county. There are people that are the working low income, and they're the people who have got money. And in this election cycle, income inequality is an important campaign issue. Bernie Sanders is flagging that right now, and Hillary Clinton is just following along. So it's an important campaign issue in this cycle, income inequality. The people who've got the money are out there, but the state has precluded you at the local level from taking that money through privilege taxes. And I understand you're hamstrung, but you're an innovative group. This community has shown technological innovation for decades. You can do it. Go in the room, get together, figure out an innovative way to get that money. You know where it is. Get it for this community. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Mike. Mr. Steve Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman,
Commissioners.
I come to you tonight representing a local grassroots organization known as Alamance Conservative. Now, some of you might call us Tea Party. I don't know how many people actually know what that means. Tea Party, T-E-A, stands for Taxed Enough Already. That's all it really stands for. That and the fact that we feel like we need conservative fiscal control of government. That means that you need to be paying attention to the budget. Your job as commissioners is to make sure that the people that manage the departments are running their departments efficiently. That means you need to do some searching and checking. I can't imagine over the year, I can't count over the years. I was in finance for 40 years, almost 40 years. How many times I've seen businesses that had sacred cows in their budget, things they paid for every year because they thought they had to pay for it, but they didn't. And once somebody pointed it out to them, they took a second look at it, started finding ways to save money. Now, I know you think you've saved everything you can, and the last thing I want to see is us continue to balance the budget on the backs of our employees. The people that work for us in service every day in Alamance County are too important to us. We don't need to have to retrain deputies. We don't need to have to retrain teachers. But we do have to look out for the taxpayers. As has been pointed out here tonight, there are many, many taxpayers who are taxed enough already. They need the support of you, in particular, those of you who took a stand in the last election not to raise taxes. You need to remember, grassroots is out there. There will be another vote. Now, thank you for your time. I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you.
Thanks, Steve. Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Mike Wilson.
Thank you. I want to give you a little insight that I received from 11-year-old. About 2 years ago, well, it was 2 years ago about this time, my oldest grandson asked his daddy, said, can I work with Pop-Pop this summer? I don't want to go to daycare. Tickled me to death. I'm a retired builder. I have rental property, and that's how I support myself now. So all summer, he worked right beside me. We cleaned out apartments, and anybody that owns an apartment knows that's a job. He experienced all that, never complained, worked all summer. Later on in the summer, we had a maintenance issue. Went to an apartment about 10:30, 11 o'clock in the morning. Knock on the door, have to wake the lady up to come to the door. We took care of our maintenance. He asked me, he says, Pop-Pop, does she work? I said, no, I don't think so. Well, we had to wake her up. I said, yeah. I said, some people work second shift, and you know, we'll try to do those later in the day so we don't wake them up, but this lady doesn't work. Well, in all of those times that we cleaned those houses out, he asked me, said, these people really don't take care of their things, do they? We found school books. School was out. School books were still in the apartment. Clothes was left behind, furniture left behind. But he was experiencing all this firsthand. So the summer was about to end, was coming in one evening. I stopped at the end of the driveway and I told him, I said, get the mail in for me. He did. He brought it to the truck and I noticed the top envelope was from Alamance County. He said, what is this? I said, I don't know. Open that up. That looks important. I knew it was my tax bill. He opened it up, and I'm not going to tell you how much it was, but it was a substantial amount. He said, Pop-Pop, said, that lady went to her house yesterday, said, how much taxes does she have to pay? Do you have to pay this much? I said, I certainly do. He said, well, how much does she have to pay? I said, well, nothing. He said, well, how does she do that? I said, well, it's based on what you own. You work, you get stuff, and you have to pay taxes on it. He said, okay. And he thought just a minute, and I could see the look on his face. He said, Pop-Pop, he said, you work every day. He said, you even work on weekends. And these people we cleaning up behind, they not working any. That just don't seem fair. I said, I agree. So I'm asking y'all, are y'all smarter than a fifth grader? Find another way to get these taxes other than raising our property taxes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. This next signature, I'm going to try it and be listening close because I can't really read it, but it looks like Alphonse Tybin. Is that close? All right, let's do it this way. 705 East Moorhead Street in Burlington. Anybody? Nobody? We will move on. Helen Kirchen. Thank you. Thank you, Helen. Appreciate it. Miss Ann Vaughn, Board Commissioner. Welcome.
Getting stiff sitting there. I'll take it from another, a little bit different view, I think. The rebranding of North Carolina is complete. We're no longer that enlightened southern state that was the destination for high-tech companies or automobile manufacturing. The real cost of the loss of Volvo to South Carolina, 9,000 employees with a $43,000 average yearly pay. Cluster of businesses grown up around the plant, 40 South Carolina companies supply parts. This was an increase of $30 billion. We're now another southern backwater full of narrow-minded, anti-intellectual folks. It's been a dramatic transformation. While our state leaders continue to hit the accelerator on more corporate tax cuts, they appear to be ready to drive public education over the cliff. We must help our educators have the resources necessary, such as textbooks, instructional resources and technology, professional pay, and other student-centered priorities. North Carolina now ranks fourth lowest in the country in fair school funding. Currently, the exodus for Alamance County employees is DSS, 24%, Sheriff's Department, 24%, and overall for all other departments is anywhere between 12 and 14%. I know the employees in DSS are superhuman, to be able to do and accomplish what they have against all odds. But 24% jumped ship before they were burned out. How long can 76% last? It is costly to replace workers because of the productivity losses, the cost of hiring and training a new employee, and the slower productivity until the new employee gets up to speed. Consider the loss of productivity of the trainer. Cost of turnover is about one-fifth of the employee's annual salary to replace that worker. We're going down a black hole and must apply brakes before there is nothing left. The fault of this is the state, not our local government. No one wants or likes a tax increase. Before the last revale, the tax rate was 58 cents. You must do the hard and difficult thing. Vote yes on the tax increase and keep our well-trained, hard-working, great work ethic employees here and keep the customers serviced. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Vaughn. Appreciate it. Next, we have Ms. Sue Rich. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board of Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight. I have great respect for the diverse perspectives that have been shared tonight. I really do. They're meaningful, I can tell, to each person who's shared their thoughts. I came to Alamance County via Elon College, it was back in the day, and have come to call Alamance County home. It is now my home. I've been here for 35 years. I grew up in Burke County, which if anybody is familiar with northeastern North Carolina, you might know where that is, but I pretty much say most of the time it's in the middle of nowhere. I have great affection for that place. I think that the people and the place are lovely, and I go back there as often as I can. I grew up one of nine children. My father was a millwright, so I know about being poor. Currently, I'm the Vice President of Human Resources at Glen Raven, and that's not to pat me on the back. I have had incredible support over the years from professors at Elon University, from teachers that I had back in the day. But if I look back at Burke County today, it is stagnant. From economic development to the state of the school system there, there's very little progress, or I would say there's probably been digression over the years. Again, I would never say anything disparaging about that location or the people because I love them. But I would not want to see Alamance County fall into that same trap of neglecting the school system and not allowing our children to have the very best. It's cliche to say that the children are our future, but they deserve more. I'd like them to be able to grow and develop as an Alamance County system, as an Alamance County citizen, through education and support that I had over the years from people that I know in this community. And so that when they have the choice, that they won't do what I did and leave home, that they'll stay here in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. William Price. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you. We've talked a lot about education tonight. I know community colleges are not in your bailiwick too much as far as salaries are concerned, but at one time, several years ago, Arkansas was the lowest paying community college program in the country. North Carolina was second from the bottom. It is now probably the bottom. So it's not just here, it's all over the state. But I didn't want to talk about that tonight. I wanted to bring a problem to you that I don't know that we've really addressed. When I moved here in 1968, my wife and I built a home outside of Elon. It's now inside Elon. That lot that we built on was measured by the old system that George Washington used. He used chains and posts and whatnot, but it's very accurate. Today, we use mostly a satellite, and that's not as accurate. And so what's happening is that lots like mine that were measured out 50 years ago are moving over 6 to 8 feet. And my neighbor has got my 6 to 8 feet and I've got theirs. That makes a real problem when it comes to your control as to lot lines, house variations from the lot, and also ill will between neighbors. The The farmer that developed my property and the one next door became very ill over this problem because one was done on the old method and the new one was done on the new method. And the one that was done on the new method wanted to move over and take about 8 feet of his property. And the only place he could get 8 feet was out of the highway. So I just bring that to you. I think that that's something that you need to look at and talk to people that are doing surveying. It is easier to use something to hit the satellite with, but it may be creating some major problems.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Price.
Thank you very much.
We'll look into that. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Next. Next we have Mary Watson. Is Mary here? Here she comes. Welcome, Miss Watson.
Thank you. I'm Mary Watson, and I wanted you all to know that there are a lot of us in this county who have been retired for a long time. My husband and I have been retired over 20 years. And even though we had two daughters who graduated from the schools here, they also graduated from NC State and went on to get good jobs. And now we've got two grandchildren who graduated from these schools and went on to college, and now they have good jobs. Our granddaughter's working for Google out in California, so she got a good education. But we have not had the increases in our incomes over these 20 years that help us to support a tax increase of this amount. We have higher medical bills, we have higher insurance bills, we have higher gasoline taxes. So there's a lot of things that we're having to pay for now that cause us to have a whole lot less to put in our pockets to pay for taxes. So just keep in mind that we're not the only ones who've been retired that long. A lot of our friends have been too. And wanted to thank you for letting me talk.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Appreciate it. Next we have William Carruthers. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm William Carruthers. With the late hour, I'll be very brief. We need teachers, and the way we get them is to pay them fairly. We need more qualified staff. They're leaving in droves for better paying jobs. We need to pay them fairly. As a senior citizen and a baby boomer, I'm willing to pay more taxes to make Alamance County a better place to live for all of them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next we have Doug Carroll. Welcome, sir.
Chairman, yes, Board of Commissioners, I'm going to give it to you from the working class that's not making a lot of money right now. I'm going to take you back sometime. I can take you way back. Me and Joe went to school at TIE together. That takes you back. If anybody knows what TIE was. Thank you, Joe. I could probably talk to you 2 hours because I got enough stuff, but I won't. And I know I can't. But, you know, I went to work for this county in school bus garage in 1980 as a gas truck driver. My check was $797 a month before taxes were taken out. I went there with the intentions of working 30 years or 28 and a half years with my vacation, sick time, and walk away. I stayed there 11 months because it wasn't my choice. It was because we had poor department heads that didn't understand what their quality workers gave them. I was fired. I'll take that back. I was given a choice to be fired or resign because of a school bus that had a safety issue that I would not let leave school at supper. Okay? The principal at Southern came down there, took his jacket off, climbed up on his school bus. I'm telling you how it is. He got up under it. He took my flashlight and I crawled up under it, showed him what it was. He said, "That bus is not leaving here." I did not have a radio in my gas truck, so we had to walk back to the office. I called the shop. The transportation director told me, he said, "You're not a mechanic, you're a gas truck driver. Let that bus run." I gave the assistant principal the coil wire, and I said, "You put it in your pocket. I got to go to the shop." When I pulled in the shop, he was standing there at the gate, made me get out of my truck. It's just a... And, you know, I lost my job because I didn't get to have somebody to represent me the next morning at the school board. And you know what? Here's going to be the final blow. My mother started to work for this county in 1955. I have seen her first paycheck stub. And some of y'all teachers in here, you're going to think about this. She brought home $156 the first month she taught. Brought home. Okay? Now, that's unheard of, but then about $156 would buy you a lot of stuff back then. And I understand people need raises, and I understand there's 278 employees in the county. A lot of them know me. A lot of them probably ain't going to appreciate what I got to say, but it's you know, y'all just need to think about raising taxes.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Next, we have Marcia Isley. Welcome, ma'am.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the Board of Commissioners. My name is Marcia Isley. I am a retired educator from the Alamance Burlington School System. I, like you, have a vested interest in Alamance County simply because I have lived here for over 40 years. I know what the most important asset in our county is, and it is our children. We must make sure that our children are taken care of. We must make sure that our educational system is highly funded. We must make sure that the strategic plan that was worked on for over 2 years is put in place and fully funded. It was worked on by people that were a part of Alamance County, that worked in Alamance County. Every child in Alamance County's parents had the opportunity to be a part of that plan and to work on it. Businesses in Alamance County had the opportunity to work on that plan. Educators work on that plan. Their plan is together. It is very, very good and very well orchestrated. Now it is time for us to implement that plan. It takes funds to implement the plan. You have the ability to fully fund the school budget this year, and I want to encourage you to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ives. I'm going to take a stab at this one, and if I get it wrong, I apologize. May Fuller, is anybody? All right, let me give you the address. 456 Witt Avenue, Burlington, North Carolina. Am I getting close to anybody? Okay. How close was I? Is it? Oh, maybe not. Okay. We'll move on, and there'll be another opportunity. Dennis Wanless? Thank you, Dennis.
Pronouncing better than I do.
Welcome, sir.
Good evening. Members of the County Commission, my name is Dennis Wanless. I'm here this evening to oppose the portion, and I want to emphasize the portion of the budget and the proposed real estate tax increase that would pay to implement the findings of the pay and reclassification study. I want to make a few quick points. First, the county ought to rely on natural growth in property and sales tax receipts for increased annual revenues. The city of Burlington has done that pretty admirably again this year. There's a reevaluation coming, and I would expect that property assessments would increase. Second, there's no such thing as a property tax. Properties and cars and trucks don't pay taxes. Everybody in this room pays taxes out of your income. So any increase to the pay of 800 or so county employees comes from the income of thousands of other county taxpayers, many of whom don't have a lot of income and don't have income security. Third, it's not the purpose or function of county government to compete with the private sector or even with other local governments on pay. It's not the purpose of county government to make itself so attractive that there won't be turnover of personnel. It's not the purpose of county government to, in effect, act as a union for its employees. 30 years ago, I worked for a city-county authority. Later, I worked for a city, both times as a blue-collar operator of a water treatment plant. So I'm empathetic to people who do physical work, who do dangerous work, who work in the middle of the night, who teach students. My daughter taught class in Chapel Hill for 3 years until the actions of the governor drove her to California for $15,000 a year more. Still, I took the positions as jobs, and that's why people work for Alamance County today. It's a good job, and it comes with good benefits. And if you read Tom Boney in the Alamance News, I think he harps on the subject better than anybody. They get dental benefits and health insurance benefits and several forms of retirement contributions and so on and so on. I buy those things if I can afford them myself. I went to the dentist today. I dropped $500. I don't have dental insurance. So the pay study and the proposed county budget means to redistribute income, and I don't think that's a very American thing to do. I don't think it's the business of Alamance County to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next we have Mr. Tony Cox.
I thought I was going to get some honorable.
Back in 2007, things were going good. And I hear a lot of people, they're worried about the kids, and they're worried about this, and they're worried about that, but you know, time and time again, I see people kicking the kids in the street. They don't care. They want the money. They claim what they need. Living high on the hog is nice. Really, really nice. You know, I could be paying thousands more dollars in taxes, sales tax, could be making hundreds of thousands to the county. But this county was on a venture to destroy people's lives with their illegal, unenforceable ordinances. And they're still happening to this day. But who cares, right? Who cares? I like this letter that I got today, or the other day, anonymous Alamance County office building showing these raises that they're getting, $77,000 to $93,000, 80, 90. Well, that's a good raise. There's a whole lot of people out here that can't pay their taxes, but who cares, right? They'll just sell their place, give it away at auction, and some other will come in and buy it up for pennies on the dollar, and they'll do better with it. That's what goes on around here. What about us out here that spend every day trying to bust our butt to do the best we can, and we get complaints against us? This complaint right here, he did work for Alamance County at Register Deeds of Office, and he has no license. He unstopped a drain line. Those people over there were suffering. Sewage backing up in the sinks, the maintenance department not taking care of it. Look at the jail over there. The building's falling apart. Where's maintenance? But we got a lot of other departments too. We got these bad ordinances, but who cares, right? Unless you're the victim. When you're the victim, oh, it's the problem. But a lot of these people, they can call up one of their friends, a county commissioner, and they'll take care of it. Or if it's one of us that it don't matter, see, the county commissioners, they'll buddy up with the side on, it's not even the government anymore. The government don't treat their people the way these people here in Alamance County do. It's the corporation anymore. That's what it's turned to. But I can assure you, I got what I need. I got what I need. Did you do this, Honeycutt? It's got your name on it. Did you do it?
Tony, no.
Well, I'm asking questions. We want to see how our money's spent. We want accountability for our money. We want accountability for what these people do.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that completes our list, and I'll ask the... With that being said, I'll ask the folks in the crowd, is there anyone here tonight that would like to speak, that has not spoken yet, would like to speak? Yes, sir. Come on up front and identify yourself. We have a couple, I think.
Thank you, Dan. My name is Randy Carey. I signed up electronically today, and that's probably why I didn't get on the list. But first of all, I want to thank you all for having the courage to sit here and listen to this debate, both sides of which are difficult. But I come to you as a private citizen, and I also come to you as a volunteer at the airport. And at the airport, the Burlington Alamance Airport Authority has been well supported by the county commissioners. And every one of you I have walked around the airport with, you all have seen what has happened, but even more a note of more excitement is what's happened at Honda. And when you all see what's going on over there and see these jobs that have been created, these are $70,000, $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 jobs. And there some kids from Alamance County are working there. But when we cut the ribbon about 6 months ago and we went around and talked to everybody and cut the ribbon, where were these engineers from? Caltech, Stanford, MIT, Virginia Tech. There were a few from NC State there. The bottom line is we need more Hondas in this county, but why do Hondas come? Well, somebody spoke early about companies looking for low tax rates. Companies are looking for an educated workforce. That's what they need, and they've got tremendous competition. And you all have had the courage to put money into this airport as an economic development tool to attract those kind of companies. So we've seen a cause and effect here. My two children graduated from this school 24 years ago, and they got great jobs. And most of you all remember when the Burlington had the supplemental tax and Burlington was in the top 10. What we need to do is go back and take a hard look at our schools, get back on track, and fund this full requested budget for these teachers. Thank you for the courage to do what you're doing.
Thank you, Randy. Appreciate it. I think we have another speaker that's approaching the podium. A couple more. Mr. Henry Vines, welcome, sir.
Thank you, commissioners. I apologize for not getting on the list, but I didn't get the memo y'all was moving. Commissioners, I think it's Commissioner Smith anyway, I stood up before y'all last year. I wonder where all these people were at last year. There was three people that stood up, and I was one of those three that spoke out on the budget last year. I spoke out on one topic about salary increases to the upper class, the higher income people getting larger increases. This is same scenarios going on this year. The lower people are getting the lower increases. The higher people are getting the higher increases. Commissioners, we have dug this hole over the past 6 years. I have stood right here every year for the last 6 years. I have said that if we didn't do something, we were digging a hole, and that one day y'all were going to come up and hit us with a 6 or 7% increase. Here we are. As a farmer in this county, it is hard to hit that much of an increase. Sure, there is needs in this county. These employees need it. These schools, we need this. But this kind of raise at this all at one time is ridiculous. You need to go back and look. I have given you where there's cuts that can be made in this county on unfunded, on unmandated things that does not have to be funded by the county. You can cut those out. There's many other things that can be cut out that we can still fund the things that need to be done in this county. Secondly, many of you I have spoken with, and many of you have supported the idea of a sales tax. There has been no action made on this. Y'all need to go back, reduce this tax rate down to a reasonable amount, pursue a sales tax. The property owners of this county are paying enough. Everyone that's in this county ought to have to pay. And sales tax is a way that everyone can pay. Commissioners, I know you have a hard decision to make, but I think this kind of an increase all at one time is going to put a burden on small businesses, seniors, farmers. We have a lot of assets. We don't make much money, but we have a lot of assets. And this is a huge increase. And also, we say it's 58 cents. We'll tack another 11 cents on there for fire tax, and you're going back to 70 cents. So, commissioners, please look at this and look for some alternatives in this increase.
Thank you. That's fine. Please state your name, sir. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Dave Gammon. I am a resident of Elon. I have two children in the Alamance Burlington school system, and I have a brother-in-law who teaches at also in the Alamance Burlington school system at Southern High School. I am I'm definitely in support of the full funding for as requested by ABSS, but I would like to speak about both sides because I have lots of good friends and family who would fall into both sides of the camp. I think there's always going to be people that will complain about taxes. You could cut taxes, you could put them in half, and there would be people that would talk about that they're too high. I don't like paying taxes either. But I think that there's a couple of issues that have not been addressed by those who are concerned about taxes. And one is the fact that Alamance Burlington school teachers are leaving. That they're leaving disproportionately. They're going to other counties, other school systems. That's well documented. And the reasons for which they leave are also well documented. They get paid better in other schools. So if we continue to hug the bottom of North Carolina in terms of how much we as a county are willing to pay for these teachers, then they will continue to leave. And that will lead to necessary consequences. And that could be felt for generations, in my view. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Yes.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Commissioner. Mm-hmm. My name is Barry Joyce, and this is about all I can handle in one night. We've got so much waste in Alamance County. It's just funny. The school system, the teachers need a raise, but it's the same problem it's always been. Central office is hogging all the money. They've always hogged all the money. I mean, if you go over there and look at the salaries of central office versus the school teachers, it's a joke. I pointed this out to the school board last year. We have like the second highest paid assistant superintendents and the 23rd highest paid teachers. So, you know, I mean, you know, I'm glad we got a new superintendent. I'm glad he's making $350,000 a year. And I'm glad Mr. Bird was able to supplement his income. But these textile mills are one of the reasons we're in the shape we're in now. They didn't ever want any education here. I worked for Alamance Community College 25 years ago. They didn't want us coming in teaching classes. They didn't want the people educated. My dad had a seventh grade education, worked double shifts in a mill his whole life. And that's what the problem in Alamance County is. That's why we only have people like Walmart and Sheets. You don't have to have a college degree to make a chicken salad sandwich. You don't have to have one to drive a tow motor. And you don't have to have one to get the county so fat. There's so much money being wasted in Alamance County. I mean, it's like a big pig in grain. I mean, every third car you see is a county vehicle. And, you know, until you guys grab a hold of this thing, until the school people, and I've talked to a lot of teachers, and they feel the same way I do, until the school system itself looks at the central office and figures out that, hey, we don't need 10 assistant superintendents in food service, you know, and passes this money down to the teachers that need it, then we're going to have problems here. And it's always going to be problems here. And you can take the students, it's like I told a teacher the other day. I said, she was talking about 80, a school had 80 on the honor roll. And I said, it was Western Middle School. I said, well, how many Graham Middle School had? 6. I said, well, you take the students from Graham Middle, put them at Western Middle, take the students at Western Middle, put them at Graham Middle, and guess what? You're going to have 80 at Graham Middle and 6 at Western Middle. The problem is not the teachers. The problem is the parents. Until we get the parents interested in their kids, and these kids are born into poverty, they're never going to escape this. And we're never going to be able to improve. You can throw all the money. Look at Baltimore, Maryland. Threw billions of dollars at it. You know, you can throw all the money at all this stuff you want to. But until the parent actually gets involved, it's never going to get any better. So I just don't see us increasing taxes. We need to take a close look at what the waste we have right now in Alamance County, which I feel like is a ton that could be relieved. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Joy. Do we have any other speakers for tonight that have not spoken? Come down, sir.
Good evening. My name is Derek Tang.
Welcome.
And I'm a late comer, actually. I was not able to make it this evening originally, but I was keeping up with the Times News tweets, and I just felt an impulse to come out here. I come to you under two capacities, one as a parent, and in the other as chairperson of Voice, which is an ABSS parent advocacy group. I would invite you to come to those meetings once the school year begins, but you're not going to hear any concerns or issues that you haven't already heard. I'm also a substitute teacher. I've seen some of you around our school buildings. You've seen the cracked mortar. You've seen the stinky bathrooms. You've seen teachers meeting in classrooms that were converted from storage closets. There are at least 3 classrooms in my children's school right now that were converted storage rooms that are being used for classrooms right now. Now, we're talking about this budget issue here that the ABSS request cannot be fulfilled, and then we're balancing that with the tax issue. I'll go on record right now. You can all hear me say it right here. I'm against a tax increase on principle. But I'm also a parent with children in the school system. I have to look at the trade-off. And if the trade-off means that I'm going to be writing a little bit extra on my mortgage payments, which are pretty sizable as they are, but if I'm going to have to make that extra payment to ensure that my children have a future in this school system, it's a no-brainer. It should be a no-brainer. And I think that needs to come into consideration by everybody, whether you're a parent or not. A concern was brought up that businesses that might come to Alamance County will look at tax rates. I believe that. But I also believe that these business owners and the families that might be coming in, they're also going to look at the school system. And these problems, I wish they could solve themselves without having to throw money at the issue. But they're not going to. The funding needs to be taken care of. And it starts with this distinguished body. And I applaud your transparency and your willingness to have this hearing. And I just hope that the right measures are taken. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Any others that have not spoken wish to speak? Seeing no hands of folks that have not spoken, then it's time for discussion. Fellow commissioners.
Can we stand up, chair?
Can I
stretch our legs?
Can I speak
for 30 seconds? No, sir, we're in the discussion now. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Can we all stand for 30 seconds?
Yes, like to stand. Folks, take about 2 minutes and get up and stand a little bit. It's been a long Okay. Matter of fact, we're going to take about a 5-minute recess. We've got some folks that need to attend some meetings.
No, we actually may have to go scare us to the bathroom.
Let me tell you about it, hang on.
guidance?
The key is, I announced that we were going into a public hearing. We were going into a public hearing for the budget.
You got to come out of it.
Huh?
You got to come out of the
public hearing. Yep, we'll have to come out of it. And before we have...
I represent a lot of people.
You got everybody here?
And I was talking to her one day. They lived down there.
I want the best for our county.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we're back in session this time.
Yeah.
Members, we need to go ahead and go out of this public hearing, and before we start discussion, do I have a motion that we go out of the public hearing at this time?
Motion to go out of public hearing.
Second?
Second.
Second. Thank you, Ms. Massey. So we're now going to the discussions by the commissioners, and commissioners, I'll receive comments from you at this time in reference to the budget.
I'll start.
You want to? I've got Bob. You want to start?
Well, Judge, you have seniority. You go ahead.
I was in the field artillery in the Army, and I haven't heard half the things that were said tonight, but I basically know what folks were talking about, because everything in this sound system just blends to me, and it hasn't been too distinct. I have some problems with the budget itself. I think, and Dr. Harris and I appreciate what you and the board are doing for the school system. I can't find too much wrong with it, and totally in favor of the teachers' new supplement STEP program that you have instituted. I think it's good. I have a problem with our pay study. I think it's been rushed too fast. As far as I know, first time I saw it was a couple of weeks ago. And I think something needs to be done. It should be delayed. It should be studied more. Something should be, it's just too fast. Again, for the teachers, for the school system, but the pay study, I'm sorry, I have a real problem with it at this time. I know there are plenty of people working for the county who need pay raises, but this study is too skewed toward upper management and the amount of money that they can receive. And not the lower paying jobs. Folks, we have some people working for the county who are on food stamps, and they need help more than our top echelon of employees. So I think we just need another study on it. That's basically all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Judge. Ms. Byrd, I think you're next, sir. Thank you.
I wanted to say a couple of things. First of all, I really believe that we need to fully fund what's being requested by the school system. I was on the vision plan committee, so I'm fully bought into achieving that vision. I know how important it is. I know how important it is to recruit doctors, which I did for the hospital, and other professionals to this community. And it very much is about economic development. And it's just the right thing for our kids. I mean, we're going to all be so much better off if our kids, everyone, regardless of whether they're from a poor family or a rich family or a broken family or a supportive family, every child, they're all of our children, and every child has to have that opportunity to succeed in life, and education is the way to do it. And once they do, that's going to be better for all of us. It's going to bring more money into this community. It's going to reduce the need for people later on to require social services. There will be fewer incarcerations, all of these things that cost us money. So it's a long-term investment that will have great returns. I want to make a couple of comments about our county employees. First of all, it's good business practice, as far as I'm concerned, to pay competitive wages to your staff. No business can be successful if you're going to have a high turnover and if you have an employee group that's not engaged serving your customers in the very best way that they can. So it's just absolutely necessary to be competitive. We don't need to be paying at the high end of the scale, but we don't need to be paying at the low end either. We have a study that was done. It shows because of our lack of funding our county employees that we are so far behind. And the pay study hasn't even been done since 1999. And so, it's a lot to chew off, but it's driven by what's competitive. I hear a lot of talk about people at the high end of the scale getting big raises, and maybe that's necessary, maybe it's not. It all depends on what's competitive for those particular positions. And I would think that maybe what we ought to look at is not just automatically handing out increases for our department managers and those that are really in the upper levels of pay based on a formula according to the pay plan, that is, so much minimum percentage increase or so much percentage every movement in a grade reclassification, but to look at each individual person in those kinds of jobs and look at them individually to make sure what we are proposing to pay them is indeed what's necessary competitively. It's not about our staff making more money. It's really about making sure that, again, our salary program is competitive. We have a lot of great workers. A lot of people don't appreciate what our county government does. You think about our EMTs that are out there saving us from accidents and when we're having our heart attacks, and the sheriff deputies who are keeping us safe, and the social workers who are protecting our elderly and protecting our youth, and the health department inspectors who make sure that our food is safe, and the nurses in the health department who are helping to control the spread of communicable disease. And it was already mentioned about the landfill workers handling all the waste that we all produce, and the library professionals in our county government who's promoting literacy and making sure that everybody has access to learning materials, and even the parks and rec professionals who are able to draw down grant money to make sure that we have a successful Hot River Trail. The election staff that manage our elections, how important is that? That we're talking about making our democracy work here by making sure that elections are run smoothly and fairly. The people that work in agricultural services who help the farmers to be most efficient and who protect our land and water resources. The professionals in the fire marshal's office who make sure that we're prepared to handle the disasters that are thrown our way. The work of government is important to all of us, and we need to make sure that we have good, qualified staff to carry out that work. And so we need to just pay competitively. I have sat down with our HR director twice and gone over the pay plan. I don't think that it's an unfair pay plan at all. In fact, there might be some exceptions, but I will say that even with the full minimum 7% that that Craig, our county manager, was proposing to increase, and with the new pay grades that are being established in that pay plan, I know that we still have several positions in several departments that are way below what similar positions or the same positions are paying in other counties around us, sometimes thousands of dollars below. So I'm not talking about people at the highest grades here, but I'm talking about individuals at the bottom of the various pay grades. So and that plan isn't doing everything all at once that is being recommended either, because there's a a plan to move people up through the grades that's probably going to take 5 or 6 or 7 years to make them competitive. We talked about, heard some words mentioned about exhausting all expense cuts before we propose any kind of a tax increase. And I just want to say that, you know, we've come through a period, a recessionary period, where I think all county departments had to go through some pretty important evaluations to figure out what could be cut because the money just wasn't there. So I think that, that's one indicator that we might have some pretty efficiently run departments to begin with. We also have the performance management program that incentivizes our department managers to operate as efficiently as possible. But what I'm not used to in county government, and many of you know, I came from the private sector, Alamance Regional Medical Center. We managed some pretty big budgets there, some pretty challenging budgets. One thing that we had was good comparative information that we could benchmark against about what's good efficiency in performing certain functions and what's not. So I haven't yet been able to obtain good comparative data on, well, just, I don't mean to pick on any particular department, but how many social workers does a community our size in another county have, or how many social workers per population, or how many sheriff deputies and things like that. So I think that over time we need to have good management information available to us. I know the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners is working on such a database, and maybe that will help us in the future. And the other thing that we need is to plan to make sure that we're holding our staff accountable for whatever money that they do make. We don't have a really good state-of-the-art performance appraisal system on which we can base merit pay as people to serve as the basis for people moving up in a pay grade over time. Those are my thoughts. I think we need to do something. I don't know if we need to do 6.5 cents, so maybe we can figure out something while we discuss this evening.
Come on, Eddie.
All right. I have two things to say here. Number one, thanks, Joe, for reminding us it was the former board that did the study on the wage salary. So they voted that in last September. Maybe. I don't know. We're 10 years behind, but whatever. Anyhow, it needed to be done.
It's fair if you just did a study on the private sector. It's fair. It would have been fair. You only did it on the county employees, it's not fair.
Well. And my second thing is to Tom, who mentions the Homestead Exemption Act for our seniors. And I think it is very important that if they don't know about it, in fact, our tax administrator is sitting over here, and I'd ask him to bring some applications for anyone that's 65 or older and income is no more than $25,600 per year. And I think that may have been increased over the years. This is a little bit old, but their tax value, if they have a $100,000 house, could be assessed at 50. So if there is any senior in the audience that's interested in this after the meeting, Jeremy Acton has some forms and he can give you this information. So I am concerned about the seniors when we talk about raising taxes. And I just want to say Alamance County has some of the best employees around. I've worked with them. I was there 4 years before, and I've seen how they operate, and we've been running behind for the last 6 years since our last revaluation when we took so long to ever get it to 54, and last year they decided we didn't need that penny. So there's going to have to be some work here to make the schools work, and I know we got some talking to do tonight, and I'm hoping we can come to a conclusion where we can fund our school and work on paying these lower paid employees, such as these deputies that are out on the road tonight making $35,000. Let's give them a raise. They deserve it.
Well, I'm for the teachers, I tell you. I have a granddaughter that's about that tall.
And I done told her her students are gonna beat her to death. But anyway, she's at Garrett, and so I do have a dog in this fight. So I would like to see the teachers get the raise. So.
Thank you. A few things that I'd like to clarify to start with. It was mentioned about the social workers that were hired, that were recommended by the county manager in his budget. State pays 75% of those salaries, so I wanted to just bring that to your attention. It'd be just a 25% match by the county for those that are very important based on the work that they will be doing. You know, this is an exciting time when you look at what's going on in Alamance County. Housing starts are up 50% right now. I've talked to several realtors who tell me that they're having problems finding houses to sell. Now, I want you to look at that and then think about how it was back just a few years ago, where every corner that you turned around, and Thomas is shaking his head, yeah, you'd see a for sale sign in the yard, folks. We went through a severe recession. I mean, a bad one, starting in about the early part of maybe the middle of 08 and then coming forward. And housing and cars, I'd always base the economy in Alamance County. I'd look at the housing starts and cars. And if they were both really down, new sales on cars and houses starts, we were in trouble. But with that being said, the county commissioners that were on the board during that time period, they had to make some tough decisions. I understand that. Judge, Linda, y'all had to make some tough decisions. When you look at the money drying up, the unemployment rate was through the ceiling, which now we know that is down, it's cut in half and more. It's much better. And the money just wasn't there. So when you look at that and you look at the tax rate, it shows. It goes right along and coincides with the economy and as it was. When you look at 08, 09, it was 58 cent on the 100. Then you had the reval. And, oh, by the way, I'll talk about that in just a second, but the reval, it was revenue neutral, was set at 52 cent on the 100. Oh, by the way, we had over 11,000 appeals because a lot of those evaluations were not right. So when that happened, as many of you citizens know, we had folks paying taxes that were all over the board. Those that had their property revalued had dropped down. Others just went ahead and continued, like me, went ahead and just continued to pay the taxes that were set. Well, what does that mean to the county commissioners? It means this. We really don't know where revenue neutral is. If you think about it, it's hard to determine that at that time. If you ask our tax collector now, he'd say it's somewhere between 54 and 55 cents on the 100 is where we're at. So it stayed 52 in 9-10, 52 in 10-11, 52 in 11-12, 52 in 12-13, then it went to 54 in 13-14, and then back to 53 last year in the 14, the current budget that we're in now. But now, why did I tell you that? Well, let's compare that to the salaries of the employees during that time period. What happened to them? Well, this is what happened to them. July of 09, no salary increase. July of 2010, no salary increase. 5 furlough days for the fiscal year. That means without pay. July 2011, no salary increase. 2 furlough days without pay. July 2012, no salary increase. 401k plan that I don't totally disagree with changed from a 2% contributory plan to a 2% match plan. County matches up to 2%. July 2013, a 5% salary increase, but by the way, in July the 15th of 2013, there was a reduction in the longevity pay of 55% to meet a $500,000 cap on spending. Then we have July 2014, the longevity plan was eliminated in the budget, and that amount was paid out in the December 13th. Longevity was added to the base pay. So just keep that in mind when you think about the employees and the job they were doing and how they were being compensated. So the previous board last year, or during this fiscal year, they decided that maybe we need to do a pay study. They hired the COG at $50,000 to do that pay study. And these are the counties that they used and cities. They used Chapel Hill, Randolph County, Davidson County, Greensboro, Mebane, Durham, Rockingham County, Caswell County, High Point, Forsyth County, Person County, Guilford County, Chatham County, Orange County, Graham, and Burlington. You have a wide variety of different sized municipalities and counties. And you also have those that we are competing when in terms of keeping our employees and teachers, by the way, a lot of the teachers. And I'll get to that in just a second. So the study is done. There were a lot of the officers and other employees that were in one particular job, but through their job description and what they actually do during the day, they should have been here. But they haven't been placed here in terms of their salary. So we see the salary that's recommended. And by the way, that's the market value on the minimum, what came up. That's the minimum salary. What you saw in the newspaper was the minimum for that particular pay slot, what you saw there. So with that being said, let me move on. What does it mean for us? Well, between 2010 and 2014, just looking at the sheriff's office, they've lost 51 experienced deputies. Now, I can't say all left to go to other locations. This is what they lost. I'm just giving you the facts here. They also lost 82 detention officers. Think of that, during that four-year period. It's not cheap to train these people. Not cheap at all. If you had to send them to basic law enforcement training school, you're talking about a large sum of money. And I've got it right here. When you look at it from, try about for a new deputy that does not have certification, about $35,000. And then you multiply that times 51 and see what you come up with, folks. Is it cost effective to lose these employees to other agencies? And they love to get them. Speaking of the teachers, while I'm on that subject, we don't just have Orange County and Guilford County and these other counties that are out here trying to hire our teachers to do a great job. We've got states, three or four different states, that are actively trying to take the teachers that we have in Alamance County away from us. It's just that simple. They see it as a training ground, and they're using it as such. Now, with all that EMTs, when I have an EMT show up at my house when I've had a heart attack, I want somebody that's well trained. Well, if we're losing them and having to retrain them, where does that leave us in terms of service? Think about those things. I know in talking with one of the things that gave the commissioners from the school system standpoint give us a little heartburn, I fully understand it, is the longevity, the teacher supplement, for principals and assistant principals. They're on and the general public really doesn't understand, but they're hired in a different way from teachers. In other words, principals and assistant principals, their salary is negotiated with the school system. And Dr. Harrison, you shake your head no if I say this wrong. They negotiate. Well, they have the state funding, and then the only other thing that they might have to help them during those negotiations is the county also, through county funding, Dr. Harrison has a little money that he can do that to offer to keep good folks as principals and assistant principals. Did I say that pretty plainly, Dr. Harrison? Okay, thank you, sir. So that covers that. I've got a lot of other things here I want to talk about. Bear with me just a second. When you look at what we're trying to do here with salaries, we've got some great employees, as the whole board has stated. They're doing great jobs. But right now, they're in stress because of the pay that they do receive. That's the bottom line. They are, and we're losing them. Are we seeing too much of this up here? I think so, Thomas, and what we're seeing. Did we maybe go too far? Maybe so. Do we need to cut it back some right now? I think so. Can we do that? Yes, we can. So with that in mind, and I finished with employees, and thank you. I want to go back to the school system just a little bit. The first time I heard about a strategic plan, I guess, and it was being talked about by Tony Rose when he was running for the school board, and that's back many years ago. And then he became the chair, and it was talked about by the current board, and they went about talking with the business community. There was a vision plan that was done by different facets of the community, and they came up with an outstanding plan. As a matter of fact, it was adopted by our previous board in how to get our school system, the vision to get our school system in Alamance County to where we want that. Now, our folks on the school board took that vision plan and they came up with a strategic plan, a workable strategic plan over several years that they're going to get that done. Why is that important? Well, as these jobs, and we're bringing a lot of jobs in this county, and they're not just cheap paying jobs, we're seeing some good paying jobs come in, but we need a trained workforce so that we keep the good students and the good kids that we have here, that they can find jobs and that they're qualified for them. And that's where that is coming from in a nutshell. Excellent working relationship with the community college right now. Dr. Gatewood has done a great job in terms of making it so most of our children in this county, they can go finish at ACC. If they want to go on to school to a state-supported school and other colleges are signing on, they can transfer in as a junior. What a great thing. We're gearing towards training the workforce on the community college level, going down into the schools to fit the jobs that are becoming available in this county. What more could you ask for, folks, when you look at that? And as we do that and as we improve that workforce, it's going to be the betterment for all of us, including the taxpayers. I hate to pay taxes. I hate to see tax increases, but sometimes it is a necessary evil. Now, with that, I would like to tender a motion to this board, and it's going to take me about 20 minutes to get through it, maybe, because it's pretty lengthy. I'd like to make a motion at this time. Looks like I still have the floor. Let me say this about Mr. Nadowski's recommendation, because it will be a part of it. Union County hired a assistant district attorney, as a matter of fact, they have several of them, to deal with the prisoners that have been in the jail, and he's touched on this, for a long time. In other words, they're just sitting there in jail, the county's feeding them. We're feeding them, we're providing the medical care. It's expensive to do that. What this assistant DA will be doing is working with Wayne Barra, who handles the bonds and getting the bonds down, and working with the DA staff to get folks bonded and to get them out when they're nonviolent. He will be working with him, making recommendations to the DA, that assistant DA, working together. Oh, by the way, Union County saved about $800,000 in hiring those assistant DAs to clean out the jail. That's a savings to the taxpayers. How will it be paid? Well, think of this. As the food bill and the medical bill and the sheriff's jail budget goes down, that $60,000 is going to come back right back to the county. And, oh, by the way, Mr. Nadowski, if this passes tonight, I want to see a report from you in December and another one in June on how we're doing, because we want to see it paid for. So enough about that. Here's my motion: that we approve the county manager's budget with the following 16 amendments. The first one is that we reduce outside agency funding by $15,559. That's JCPC, and then we were going to give other outside agencies, aside from the school, a 5% increase. We've cut that to 2.5%, so that's $15,559. We have a contingency fund for emergencies. We're going to cut that fund $510,904, it's like a rainy day fund. We will still have current funding. Why a 2% COLA was included by the COG in a pay study, I understand, but I disagree. I think we should cut the 2% COLA out of the pay study. That's a savings of $752,204 in salaries right there. Payroll update money is $112,000. That's for any changes during the year in the payroll. $112,204. That will be cut out. A development form. This is number five. A development form For farmland preservation, there's already another designated fund. We do not need to leave that money there. We can cut it out. We will. CIP funding, $150,000. That's for roof repair, et cetera. Normally, Mr. Haygood, our assistant county manager, deals with that. We'll still have $200,000 for emergencies in that fund. We're cutting $150,000. Youth homes, that's for juvenile crimes. Detention center, there's about $10,000 of that that you'd normally not use that will be cut. Elections contingency funding, this is for voting machines. Our North Carolina General Assembly has, this is for current voting machines should they break down and for the safety of that so that we can provide the voting machines. But as I say that, they have passed a bill that we have to use voting machines to provide a paper copy, even though they're computers. That's $1.8 million, folks. This board sent a resolution to our local delegation. We'd have had to do it this year if it hadn't been that our local delegation sponsored a bill in Raleigh. It's gone through the House. It's in the Senate. It's coming back to the House. It will pass. It'll be 2019. The life expectancy of our current machines will be met at that time. We're not wasting money. That's $1.8 million that we'll save until that time period. But that $86,000 for that contingency is being cut. Fire service contingency, David Leonard, that's fire marshal for radios and templates, $11,000. CECOM fiber optics, 9/11 rainy day funds, $10,000. A&E designated funds, that's for 4-H and board 4-H activity. They have other funding, we're cutting that $30,000. And then the departments have been asked by the county manager, and they have cut their budgets, their overall budgets. This is the county departments inside the county by 1.5%. So that brings us another $391,073. Going on to item number 13, if you keep in count here. Is to cap the salaries in this pay study plan. The average salaries prior to the COLA being cut were 7 to 14%. The low being 7, the high 14. Now that the COLA's cut, it's between 5 and 12%. So this next recommendation is that we cap the salary increases for those that make above $50,000 at 12%. We cut it at a 12% increase, which will be a savings of $43,000. Item number 14 is that we provide an additional funding to the schools. We add to their funding $250,000, and that's for their operating budget. And that would bring the total to $3.3 million of the $3.4 million that they have requested. Dr. Harrison, can you live with that? Okay, thank you, sir. Item number 15 is the district attorney position at $60,000. It will come out of the budget, the jail budget. And then item number 16 is the manager, the attorney, the county attorney, the county manager, and the tax collector work at the pleasure of the board. Therefore, we will determine their salary after evaluation in December, and that's as it should be. So those are the 16 amendments that I have and recommendations to the board, and I make that motion formally at this time. Do I have any discussion, or do I have a second?
What's the tax rate?
I'm sorry. That's the most important part. Thank you, Judge. Tax rate, going back and looking at where we were at, the year prior to the reval in 07-08 was 58 cents. So I'm recommending a 5-cent tax increase in this budget.
At 58 cents.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, now, this is kind of a misnomer. The 2008 budget at 58 cents, we had the reval in 2009, I think, so it's gone up, and there's a lot more money collected. At 59.5 cents, it would have been $12 million more dollars than in 2008. I don't know, you're cutting, what, 1.5 cent off of these proposed tax rate?
Yes, sir.
Well, then it's probably $10 million more than 2008. So the numbers don't jive at all.
Well, if you take and say 1.2 million is what the right now one penny brings in, and you say that times five, that comes up to 6 million, doesn't it? That gets you a lot closer, Judge.
Now, the value of the real estate went up substantially in 2009, so that the tax rate.
And you stated a figure of $10 million.
That's what I think a 5% or 5 cent increase would be this year. Would be $10 million more than 2008 when it was 58 cents.
Sir, any further comments?
Well, I just want to make sure one thing is that we're adding $250,000 to the school system's budget.
Yes, sir.
And it was recommended to be at 2.8, and they requested a $3.4 million increase. So I think that there's another $250,000 that was in the manager's proposal for capital. For clarification, we're putting that into operations, right? So it's really $250,000 to operations. So that's $500,000 on top of 2.8. That's $3.3 million. So we're only $100,000 short from the original request. And Dr. Harrison, I think you're saying that that's acceptable.
Yes. That is correct.
And I would just like to comment about the 5 cent. If we pass 5 cents, I want to say that I'm sensitive to taxpayers too. And somehow the other counties around us that we already went over how much those counties tax, low-income people are living in those communities. But just to be realistic about what 5 cents means, if you take an average homeowner with a median valued home and then that has two cars, that means a $69 increase per year or about $5.76 per month, about $5.76 per month.
Well, and just to expand on that, I know there's been some misinformation that's been put out to the general public. 1 cent tax, one cent on your property taxes is $10 on a 100,000 evaluation. So that's what so we're
5 talking. Cents would be $50.
Yeah, 5 cent would be $50 per 100,000 valuation. And that's not to say that's not a lot of money. So I know from some folks it really is. So I do have a motion on the table. Any further discussion? Do I hear a second?
I'll second it.
I have a second. All those in favor? I'm going to ask that you raise your hands. All those who are in favor, please raise your right hand. Four. Those opposed? Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we do have a commissioner's meeting going on. We've got a lot more business, but I'll leave it up to you whether you want to stay or not. There's three or four more other things going on here. And
you want a picture with a show of hands?
4-1.
You want a picture of the show?
I said increase. There'll be some head rolling next year.
All right. Next item on the agenda is a bond funding request for the Alamance Burlington School System. Jay Fuller and Dr. Todd Thorpe. Are they here?
Dr. Harrison is. Maybe he
didn't. Dr. Harrison, you going to speak on this? I'm coming. Oh, okay. He's coming. I'm sorry. Here comes Dr. Thorpe.
I had to get my line.
Welcome, Dr. Thorpe.
Thank you, sir. I bring to you tonight our request for bonding, for bond money, for funding summer projects such as roof repair and painting of schools and architectural fees for a Broadview Cummins High School project of adding additional classrooms in existing space.
All right, sir.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Next on the agenda, item number 7-2 is Capital Buildings Reserve Fund Expenditure Request, Brian Haygood.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Here this evening to ask that you consider approving funds for us to use to remove asbestos tile and glue that have been discovered at the former Computer Training Center at 423 North Graham Hopedale Road. Information in your packet says that we believed, when we submitted this, we had just found it. We had to get it into your packet. We thought the price would be close to $10,000. We've since had quotes come in. We believe $3,000 approved from the Capital Reserve Fund will cover the cost. Our low bid is $2,248, but we would like to have a little bit of a cushion on that. So we're asking this evening that you approve the County Facilities Department spend $3,000 from the Capital Reserve Fund. The current balance of the Capital Reserve Fund is $25,330.62. If you approve us spending up to $3,000 to abate this asbestos, the new balance would be $22,330.62. And I'll answer any questions that I can.
So moved. We have a motion from the judge.
Second the judge
by our vice chair. All those in favor signify saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
And then finally, we have a budget amendment, NC-Tier 2 grant. Dave Leonard?
Yes, sir.
Come on up, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I appreciate the opportunity to come to you to ask for this budget amendment here for North Carolina Department of Public Safety, specifically North Carolina Emergency Management, has awarded Alamance County's LEPC $1,104.04. We accept this budget amendment. This money will be used through our LEPC for training and planning purposes, specifically with that of hazardous materials.
Thank you, sir.
I make the motion that we approve.
Second.
Motion and a second. Without further discussion, all those in favor signify saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any further commissioners' comments before we adjourn?
I just want to make one. It's been a tough budget season. We've spent a lot of hours sitting in chairs, listening to everybody's request, and I appreciate what Craig has done. I know it's been a tough task putting all this together, and it's been a tough year, and I just appreciate the work that our staff has done, and no, I didn't want to raise taxes, but I got to go home and face my wife tonight, but whatever.
I'm going to catch it, too. I know this guy. Any further? Hearing no further comments, meeting is adjourned. Thank you, folks.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.